Lesson 4 is a lesson of promise fulfilled. God fulfills his promises. How many prophecies? I can count at least 3 off the top of my head in today's gospel reading that God fulfilled. The prophecy that he'd be called a Nazarene. The prophecy that Jesus would come. The prophecy that God would bring him out of Egypt. God fulfills his promises. But since you're not Israelites and you're not in Egypt, what does that promise look like for you today? I did a 6-month independent study on Luther's commentary on Galatians. So when the Galatians reading come up today, how could I resist? How could I not go there? Huh? Galatians 4:4. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son, born of woman, born under the law. When the fullness of time had come, what does that mean? Think about that. God exists outside the realm of time. Time is just an element within God. I'm going to get philosophical here. St. Augustine said that in the kingdom of heaven, there is no time. Therefore, there is no past and there is no future. It's just an ever-eternal now. On earth, that's the only glimpse of the kingdom of heaven we get. The kingdom of heaven, the ever-eternal now, and then a millisecond later now, and then now, and then now, and then now. We just get glimpses of the kingdom of heaven. So time does not relate to the kingdom of heaven. Time exists for a purpose. That purpose is for God to put his rescue mission into place. What are 2 definite things about time? Always has a beginning, always has an end. God is working through time to bring his fallen, broken creation back to himself. What is the fullness of time in this instance? God prepared the way for his Savior to come. He prepared his people. And when the time was right, he sent him. It's what Paul's saying in Galatians. Time has a purpose. And he not only sent him, he sent him born of woman. Why? Well, as I talked with the kids, God is not captive to his law. The law is the creation of God. He is above and beyond the law. If God had to abide by his own law, every one of you would go to hell in an instant. That's what you deserve for your sin. That's just, that's right, that's the law. If you get a killer on the stand, okay? He says, I'm really sorry that I killed those people. I'm really sorry. The judge says, you know what the law says, that you need to go to jail for this, but we get it. We believe you, we believe you're sorry, and let him go. Is that just? But that's exactly what God does to you, each and every one of you, when he forgives your sins. God is not captive to the law. He goes beyond the law and gives grace. But to end the old covenant of the law, God had to be born under the law, under its authority. Therefore, he's born of woman. But he needed to be the perfect human. Therefore, he had to be born of a virgin, avoiding original sin. So he was born as the perfect human and the perfect God, so he could fulfill the old covenant and create the new one, where faith alone, not works of the law, saves people. That was the first verse. How do you like that? I'm going to be here a while. No. To redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons. It says as sons. Keep in mind in the Greek, whenever they're talking to a mixed crowd, sons and daughters, they use the masculine. So literally it says sons, but in the culture it meant sons and daughters. So that we, under the law, us, might receive adoption. Remember the covenant representatives? Allie paid the penalty for McKenna's trespass. It's a new covenant. God sent a covenant representative, perfect human, perfect God, to end the old and create the new, so that his righteousness could be passed on to us. Paul uses the illusion of adoption because that was familiar in the Roman culture. That's why he says adoption. In his time and place in Galatia, in the Roman culture, adoption was common. People had, you know, what would happen is you'd have a baby and it's a girl and you didn't like it, so you threw it in the street. So somebody would come along and they were barren and couldn't have a baby, so they'd pick up that baby and raise them and they'd adopt it. It's hideous, I know, but it's the way it was. So that's why he uses the word adoption. But we are adoptive. How do we get into Abraham's covenant? We're not Israelites. We're not Jewish. But that's how we get in the covenant. We're grafted in, the Gospel of John tells us. We're grafted into the branch. We're adopted into God's as children. And because you are sons, God has sent the Spirit of His Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father! Abba is a Hebrew word. It has the same text and meaning of daddy, of compassionate father. Daddy, help me. You cannot cry out to God for compassion and grace without the Holy Spirit in your heart, this says. And you cannot have the Holy Spirit in your heart unless you believe in Jesus. That's why God sent Jesus, so that He could have someone for you to believe in, so that He could give you the Holy Spirit, and you could cry out to Him for mercy, and He can grant it outside the law. Salvation takes place outside the law. Now, while we are still here on earth, we are both sinner and saint, so the law still applies to the sinner side of us. It's not until our physical death that we're free from the law. We're free from the law eternally. We're not free from the law while we're physically here. So don't go into antinomianism that says there's no more use for the law because we've got the gospel, as many places have done today. So you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir through God. Do slaves inherit anything from their masters? It's the firstborn son, right? That inherits something from the father. You formerly were slaves to sin, not worthy of the inheritance of eternal life that Christ gives. But Paul tells us, you are no longer slaves. You are no longer in Egypt, but you are sons. And as sons and daughters, you are heirs to what the Father has, eternal life, the kingdom of heaven. Now that's good news, folks. It's about time I got a gospel sermon. Took them long enough to get to Galatians, huh? Amen. Thank you, Dennis. Go ahead. You can say it louder. Amen. Amen. All right. Attaboy. Thank you. Thought I heard it. And I got one ear plugged, so you know. So how's that for you? God intervenes in human tragedy. He uses you to do so. God protects His mission here on earth at any cost, even if it means giving of Himself completely and fully to a creation that does not want Him or does not think they need Him. God guides you every moment of your life and His mission for you. And God fulfills every promise that He gave you. Everyone. Regardless of whether it's fair or not. I do that with Joey and Allie all the time. It drives them nuts. It's not fair, Dan. Well, Jesus died for you. That wasn't fair either. Oh, yeah. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we thank You that You have called us to serve You by loving and serving our neighbors. Holy Son of God, we thank You for Your protection, Your guidance, and Your fulfillment of Your promises. We ask, Lord Jesus, that You continue to give us the strength, faith, hope, and love to go into this broken world, unwanted and unappreciated, to call Your people unto Yourself. In the precious name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. I'll abandon every selfish thought. I'll surrender everything I've got. You can have everything I am. Imperfect.